Krishi Gyan Deep lecture series initiated by CCS National Institute of Agriculture Marketing. Experts cannot be everywhere, therefore God created media. How we are going to use media for reaching the last mile is the responsibility of national institutes like ours. So in this direction, we have initiated a concept called Krishi Gyan Deep lecture series. In this series, the experts in a particular domain which is relevant to agriculture marketing and agriculture development, farmers' welfare, will be invited to NIAM and they will deliver the talk based on their experience and highlighting the good practices which need to be adopted by policy makers, administrators and farmers, and that will be disseminated in the form of a short films in local language with the help of DD Kisan or other channels to the doorstep of every farmer in this country. We all know that India is a very big country. We have 6.25 lakh villages. If you look at extension worker to farmer ratio, for every 1162 farmers, there is one extension worker. You can just imagine whatever we talk here, taking to the last mile is a Herculean task. So we have initiated this by introducing this concept of Krishi Gyan Deep lecture series. This year we have planned 8 talks. The first in the series is by Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji, and that is on doubling farmers' income. I would like to take this opportunity to briefly introduce the speaker. Dr. Ashok Dalwai was born in a place called Kaujaligi in Karnataka in a farmer's family, and he completed his education in Saini school. Then he completed his BSc Agriculture and MSc Agriculture Economics from Dharwad Agriculture University. While he was completing his master's, he got through UPSC examination, and during that point of time, he was one of the youngest IPS officers in the country. In the first attempt, he cleared Indian Police Service. Later, the very next year, he got into Indian Administrative Service and allotted the cadre of Orissa. You know, when 25-30 years back, you can just imagine how Orissa was, you know, now itself many backward districts are there. He was posted as Deputy Commissioner of one of the most backward district called Kalahandi. I would like to bring to your notice, in the latest newspaper, the Orissa government declared that Kalahandi is hunger free. This work started nearly 25 years back by Dr. Ashok Dalwai as Deputy Commissioner. His contribution is immensely remembered by largely the tribal population there and other developmental departments and by the people of the districts. Later he got an opportunity to work as Deputy Commissioner in another backward district in Karnataka called Raichur, and he became the talk of the town and the talking point of every citizen in this particular district because of his pro-people approach. Later he shifted his karmabhumi to the capital city of Karnataka, Bangalore. He was given the responsibility of Commissioner Bangalore Municipal Corporation, and that is the time the seeds of transforming the Bangalore into Silicon Valley of India was sown by Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji. Today if you see the big IT companies in Bangalore, the person behind initiating that entire process is Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji. Later he was elevated as additional secretary in Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, Government of India, and he handled several portfolio, and one of the small responsibilities, he was also in charge of marketing, indirectly taking care of National Institute of Agriculture Marketing. Then one of the important contribution which will be remembered by the agriculture development history in the country by Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji is being the chairman of the Prime Minister. Honorable Prime Minister came out with the idea of doubling farmers' income. It is not the productivity, it is the profitability which adds to the quality of the living standard of the farmers, and one of the most competent professional administrator in the country, was selected, handpicked by Honorable Prime Minister and made the chairman of Interministerial Committee on Doubling Farmers' Income. So I had the opportunity to be part of this Doubling Farmers' Income Committee for contributing to the extension component. I could see the never-dying spirit of Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji, simultaneously talking to hundreds of stakeholders in different parts of the country, conducting 10-12 meetings, giving directions, guidance to different people, and you know, taking the best out of every professional and putting it in the form of a document. Today, if you go to Ministry of Agriculture website, you can find 14 chapters of Doubling Farmers' Income, and every word, every sentence is carefully written based on the contribution made by these experts under the guidance of Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji. Maybe in future, if we look at the agriculture development history in the country, probably that will be divided into only two parts. It is the before Dr. Dalwai committee report and after Dr. Dalwai committee report. Such a illustrious personality is in front of us. Now I request Dr. Ashok Dalwai ji to come here and address the gathering on Doubling Farmers' Income. Thank you very much.
It's very difficult to speak about Doubling Farmers' Income. Before I speak, let me first thank Dr. Chandrasekhar. I know him for almost 3 decades now. We belong to the same university. And I know many others from this institute. Then many youngsters are sitting here. So it is like being at home to be speaking on this occasion. And whatever we have done on this strategy for Doubling Farmers' Income, it's been a contribution of several people across the country. The farmers themselves, farmers leaders like Prashant Kumar, the trade and industry bodies, the scientists, the academics, the bankers, the NGOs, and all kinds of people, including the students. Any strategy has to be participating. There is no single person who really knows everything about everything, or does not know everything about anything for that matter. We must have engaged not less than 1,000 people. When I say 1,000 people, people with knowledge, with inputs, who had something to say. And I'm happy to share with you that Dr. Chandrasekhar himself and Dr. M. I. Yadav from this institute have made very solid contributions to different parts of our report. So I must thank you both and others. It's very difficult really to speak about the entire thing. I would always suggest that you should visit our website www.agri.co. Please write down. I think you would rather benefit from that than hearing me. www.agri.co.nic.in. Okay, to repeat, www.agri.co.nic.in. So this is a website of our department, and once you go to the home page, go to the window on Doubling Farmers' Income. So as it opens, you will find there are 14 volumes, and you will find that I guess 13 volumes, volumes 1 to 13, it says download. That means they are already up on the website. You can access those things. Volume 14 is the final volume that comprises comprehensive recommendations. And that's not put up on the website because that has been submitted to government. So that also comes on the website soon. there could be more than 3,000 pages altogether. So it tries to encapture the entire march of agriculture since 1947 till date. And apart from the time frame, what is more important is agriculture is such a complex and vast subject that it is extremely difficult to write anything within one or two words. Yet, when it goes to the farmer, we must be able to communicate in a very precise and concise manner. The farmer, or anybody else for that matter, whoever is in business or any kind of enterprise, is not willing to listen to your volumes. Nobody wants to listen to philosophy, nobody wants to listen to huge compendium. What you require is, what do I do? That's all. But it is left to people like you and me to read, understand, regurgitate, and tell them what to do. But before telling them what to do, it becomes the responsibility of the government to create that kind of environment, what's called a policy framework. Without a conducive policy framework, you can't have any change. I guess the situation across Africa and India is the same. In fact, now a lot of people from Africa are coming forward to say, particularly from Nigeria, that we would also like to adopt your doubling farmers' income strategy. Please tell us what you are doing. And as I told you, I was in Kathmandu last week and all the SAARC nations had met there. They are also very keen about DFI strategy of India. Now, doubling farmers' income is actually one of the goals of the Sustainable Development Goals. All nations across the world are committed to achieving Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. There are 17 important points to which all of us are committed. Now, all of us sitting in this particular hall must be happy and simultaneously feel pressurized and responsible that of the 17 points that we have listed there, as many as 8 relate to agriculture. That means agriculture is a basis of human life, human society, welfare. And there are certain points which are directly related to productivity and incomes. So, Sustainability Development Goal number 2 relates to doubling productivity and it relates to doubling farmers' income by the year 2030. And in the same section, 2.3 says that we shall do it on a sustainable basis. That means sustainability is very important. Sustainability is important because we are not here in the race. We are not here to say I am number one. We are here to improve the lives of the people and more particularly the welfare of the farmers. And we have seen that all technologies practiced so far have not been sustainable. Let us take the particular example of Green Revolution. What is Green Revolution technology? It is based on what is called a miracle seed. You have a good seed which is responsive to intensive use of inputs like fertilizer and water, and then the yields double, triple. Like in all our continents, wheat and paddy for example, the wheat seeds came from Mexico thanks to the father of Green Revolution, Norman Borlaug, and the paddy seeds came from International Rice Research Institute, Manila, Philippines. Both of these actually carried a specific gene which shortened and dwarfed the varieties, increased the size of the grains, panicle in case of paddy and the earhead in case of wheat. Actually, both the panicles dwarfed it. And then more of fertilizer and more of water you give, more of yield it gives. And that's how the food deficit of all these countries actually was addressed over a period of 5 to 7 years. Like say Asian nations, India, China, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, all these nations for example, they were suffering from such food deficiency in 1960s. They had no option but to actually import these seeds, adopt them and meet the food scarcity. So what really happened at that point of time was a reaction. There is a fire in the building, you needed to douse it at any cost. It really didn't matter what whether you used water or sand to douse it, but you had to douse it. So likewise in India or all these nations, it was more a reaction. We had to meet the food requirement at any cost. Just to remind you, Lal Bahadur Shastri was the Prime Minister then. He gave a call to the nation, appealing to the people that you must fast at least one meal a week. That was the scarcity. In any case, in India, people are used to upvas, fasting, on the rituals and the religious grounds. They said, alright, why don't we start fasting now? So that means we had to react. So what we see today is, the Indo-Gangetic plain, which is the bed of food revolution in our country. The states of Western Uttar Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana, which actually took to heat and belly. Today we see that the water has depleted. When in Punjab, for example, where the water was available at 10 feet or 20 feet, has now gone down to 100 feet also in some places. The soils have become acidic, soils have become alkaline. That means the technology that we adopted has actually resulted in deleterious impact on the natural resource, soil and water, which are the two critical components of any agriculture production system. And you go to any irrigation command area in the country, where Tungabhadra belt, Krishna Godavari belt, Kaveri Delta, anywhere you go, you will find that problem soils are increasing. To give you a statistics, out of 141 million hectares of net cultivated area in India, it's very large, 141 million hectares, it is second to United States alone. It surpasses China, surpasses Russia, Canada, Australia in terms of area under cultivation. So out of 141 million hectares, as high as 24 million hectares are today what are called problem soils. That means they are not fit for cultivation. Or you can cultivate but yields won't be good. They become acidic, alkaline and saline. So today in Punjab what has happened is, where the average yield of paddy is 4.2 tons per hectare, if you want to raise 1 ton of paddy, the quantity of fertilizer and water that you needed to add today is more than what was required yesterday. In terms of economics, it means that marginal returns are decreasing. Or you need to throw more hardware to get the same kind of an output. So yields have plateaued over the last about 10 years. So this is not a sustainable model. We need sustainability. That means year after year, decade after decade, the soil structure, soil fertility has to be maintained in such a manner that we must be able to get increasing yields at lower cost. Cost is very important. The second aspect of sustainability is, of course, the atmosphere. Today, the atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere, as it relates to agriculture, is in terms of climatic parameters, rainfall, temperature, humidity. These are important factors because crops are what are called photosensitive. Some are photosensitive, some are not, but most of them are photosensitive. That means the intensity of light matters. What is the length of darkness, length of daylight? They all matter. The temperature matters. The rainfall pattern matters. But today, sustainability on account of these things is getting impacted thanks to the climate change. The world has been maintaining climatic barometric records since 1888. Maybe some Western countries may have maintained a little before that. But mostly, by and large, since 1888, continuously, we have been maintaining the barometric values. If you look at this 100 years now, since 1888, there is certainly a change in the pattern. And climate change is no more an esoteric subject that is discussed in journals, or in the drawing rooms, or in the workshops. It is a certainty. The only thing is that can we now respond appropriately and check the negative impacts of climate change? Two factors, rainfall and temperature, let's take them. In the 21st century, what we expect is that the temperature may rise by 4 degrees Celsius. If the temperature rises by 4 degrees Celsius, imagine what kind of impact it will have on the cropping system, another subsistence of agriculture, aquaculture, dairy, livestock, etc. So our aim, the world together, one of the commitments that all of us have made at the Inter-Parliamentary Committee on Climate Change, IPCC, is that let's try and limit this rise in temperature to 1 to 1.5 degrees Celsius. That means rise is sure. Only thing is, can we limit it to 1.5 degrees Celsius? And look at the rainfall. Based on the IPCC parametric values, India and many countries have already worked out how many districts are extremely critical to climate change, how many of them are critically drought prone, etc. Very interesting one thing is that what climate change is going to have general negative impact, but it also would have positive impact somewhere, like Canada and you know, northern hemisphere, cold countries may benefit because temperature is going to rise and they will be able to cultivate better. But our continents, which are already hot, are going to get hotter. The only place in India which is going to benefit from this is a place called Purba. That is what is the latest finding. I don't know whether it is something to do with Mahatma Gandhi's birth. You know, Mahatma Gandhi was born in a place called Porbandar. So now by the latest IPCC parametric values, they say Porbandar might be a place where the most conducive environment for cultivation may exist. Okay, so there is something, you know, on this Gandhi Jayanti day also. If you look at the rainfall pattern, over centuries, the seasonal patterns have given rise to particular agricultural subsystem. So like in India, we got Kharif, June to September, that is the first growing season. Got Rabi, October to January, Feb, that is the second growing season. And then the summer season thereafter. Three seasons we have. So India is blessed that very few countries can actually cultivate three crops a year. That's how I said that though India is only seventh largest in terms of geography, in terms of cultivable area, it is second. Because most parts of Russia and China can't be cultivated. Whereas India, every single inch can be cultivated. So now this, thanks to the shifting rainfall pattern, the seasonality is also changing. You must have read in the paper yesterday that rainfalls would withdraw from Rajasthan because first they hit Kerala in June, they reach Rajasthan and then they start withdrawing. Normally by September 1st, the rainfall started withdrawing. But this year, the rainfalls started withdrawing on October 1st, yesterday. And this has been happening fairly visibly over the last few years. That means the rainfall withdrawal is late, which is going to impact harvesting. We had unseasonal rains when the crops are standing there in the field, already mature, grains are formed. And if we have rains at that point of time, the quality is going to suffer. It's going to be prone to more of pests and more disease, for example. And the farmers were used to sowing the crop by June or July. But if the rainfalls are setting in late, that means season has already got postponed. So it's setting in late and ending late. It's going to call for a change. New seeds, new cultivation practices, new kind of adjustments to temperature, rainfall, humidity. All the cultures which are related to agriculture seasons will have to change. Our songs have to change, our life patterns have to change. So many things will be changing. So climate change is another important thing that is going to impact sustainability. So there are certain factors in our control, soil and water management. But this climate management is a larger issue. It's related to the carbon footprints, the intensity of greenhouse gas emissions, etc. So all of us, the world together, has to see how greenhouse gas emissions are controlled. Now, coming back to the farmer and the farmer's welfare, I just gave you this context to say that what we have done so far has been more reaction in nature. There has not been a response. As students of English, you distinguish the meaning of reaction and response. A reaction is innate, is natural. It is indigenous. There's a snake in front, all of us might scuffle out of this room. That is the first reaction. But a response is a guarded reaction. It is well thought of, based on information, based on reasons, data, facts, interpretations. The decision we are taking is conscious. So today we need to respond. So what is that response today required? That everywhere across the globe, the farmer, which is the, because farming is the first organized profession that humankind has evolved. 10,000 years ago when human history began, it began with domesticated animals. And then it began with clearing the forests, sowing the seeds, checking for wild varieties in the forest and checking whether they could be domesticated. For example, rice, Oryza sativa. It was a wild race found in the forest. In fact, incidentally, the district of Koraput in Odisha is supposed to be the home to Oryza sativa, one of the land races of rice. So, 10,000 years ago, when human settlement began with domesticated animals and agriculture, and since then, all these 10,000 years more or less, we have been practicing what is called a production-oriented system of agriculture. We needed to produce something, we needed to grow something. And why we needed that? We wanted to consume it. That means consumption was the primary aim of production. So the entire agriculture system, whether it is cropping system, whether it is livestock, dairy, fishery, aquaculture, beekeeping, mushroom cultivation, or any kind of thing, it was all produced only to eat. Then all the poorer countries, like ours, mouths were the natural markets. Human population had mouths. They needed to feed themselves because biological requirement was to have food. So mouths were the natural markets. Since domesticated animals like cattle were our companions, were also our compatriots working on the farm, they were also mouths, they needed to be fed. So whether we grew grains or fodder, there was a natural market. But then with the new technology that was offered in the 1960s, where the yield started increasing, the surpluses began to increase. You must have seen in your own homes. Of course, now you are belong to a different generation. You should ask your fathers and grandfathers that when they grew in the villages, 95% was eaten at home. 5% was shared with the relatives. The father took that to his daughter's home. He gave a bit of it to his neighbor. That there was nothing much to actually go and sell in the market. But then over a period of time, surpluses began to increase. We could sell it then in the village market. We could then possibly go to larger town market. Or we could then reach out to larger markets. In India, what has happened is that our surpluses in certain commodities have increased by such geometric proportion that today all that we produce in a country we are not able to consume. We need markets beyond the animal mouths, beyond the human mouths. So that is the biggest problem. That is the challenge. So today the challenge in India is that am I producing the right quantity? Am I producing the right kind of commodity? So the challenge lies in finding a market. Why? Because the farmer today is moving away from subsistence economy to a commercial economy. In a subsistence economy, more than 80% of what one produces eaten is at home. But in a commercial economy, not more than 40% is eaten at home and at least 60% is disposed of in the market, so that he is able to convert that into money and build a better home, buy better clothes, send children to school, buy medicine for his family, and also undertake tours and travel and see other parts of the world, read books, see dance programs. Right? So this is what is called evolution of the needs of the humankind. Now the needs, those of you who have read a bit of psychology, you have heard of what the person called Maslow, right? Maslow is the one who defined what is the need hierarchy. And a human being has got first a biological need, that is food, and then it goes up. He wants then social security, then he wants affection, and then he wants recognition. Then he wants what is called self-actualization. That means he is doing something for the sake of doing. He is reading because he loves reading. He travels because he loves reading, traveling. But do our farmers have that opportunity? That's the question. Beyond eating and surviving, which is a vegetative phenomena, like a plant or an animal, as a human being, where he's got faculties of thinking, of discerning, of wanting to take up adventures, unless you have excess of money with you, you cannot do all these things. So when you talk of doubling of farmer's income, we are basically talking about income approach to agriculture. So we will have to shift from production basis to income basis. And if income basis has to be achieved, we need to generate surpluses and generate those surpluses to then market it. And what can be marketed is only where there is a demand for it. So ultimately we will come down to the basic principles of demand and supply. If we want to increase the income of the farmers, we need to create a demand-oriented surplus. And that's where the strategy has to change. If we need to have a demand-oriented strategy for the farmers, we must also examine it in the context of WTO. Because today, no country is secluded from others. All the countries are signatories to the World Trade Organization. And WTO has brought about integration. This is a global market. There is a limit on every country on the element of subsidy that can be passed on to the farmers. Given that, where we can't really do too much of protectionism, we will have to look at the demand across the globe and not just within our countries. Therefore, our strategy for doubling farmers' income and increasing farmers' income is to move towards what is called a market-oriented economy. When you want to have a market-oriented economy in agriculture, first thing is to prepare the farmer to face that. Because farmers cannot face this kind of a situation where they need to compete with not just the neighbor but somebody sitting elsewhere. He has to be well informed, he has to have knowledge, he has to have access to technology, the best of technology, because he has to produce at cost efficiency. So the three basic variables that any agriculturist should look at is what is the productivity? Second, what is the cost of production? Third, what is the price that he is getting on his produce? These are the three basic variables. Any small shopkeeper also looks at these three things. How much am I investing? How much are my operational costs? And how much is my net profit? We have never looked at agriculture as an enterprise. We have always looked at as a natural profession or an inevitable profession, subsistence profession. But if you want now it to become a commercial profession where farmers are able to generate net profits, then we will have to adopt a strategy where per hectare yields are maximum, or per cattle milk output is maximum, or per hectare water body of fish output is maximum. Only when we look at higher productivity per unit of asset will be laying the step towards doubling of farmers' income. Second one is to remind you, we are not in a race. Yes, I can increase the yield provided I am putting more of inputs into that. But there is always what is called optimality. We should never aim at maximization. We should look at optimal production. That means what is the increase I'm able to achieve productivity at lower cost? It's only under, you know, system of race, competition that you can simply maximize without reference to cost. But in a field situation, we need to adopt input management so efficiently that we are able to produce optimal output at the most efficient manner, in a most efficient manner. The cost of production is very important. So we'll have to adopt all strategies to reduce the cost of cultivation, to reduce the cost of production. That's very important. And third one, of course, we have seen many situations. Let's take the case of Kolar, where tomato is very popular. Every year we see that tomato is grown, is sold at 50 paise during the glut season, and then the prices will go to 20 rupees a kg, 30 rupees a kg, sometimes even beyond that. Or you see the farmers of Uttar Pradesh, you know, bringing the canister of milk and pouring onto the streets and saying that there's so much I don't have market for my milk. So why is it happening? Or you see the onion prices. The women are crying because they have to pay 80 rupees a kg or 100 rupees a kg to buy onion. And without onion you can't do cooking in our families. And here is a farmer simultaneously who is not getting more than 4 rupees a kg for the same onion. Why this kind of a hiatus? The farmers are not getting the right prices one side, but the consumers are paying through their noses on the other end. So the price that the farmer gets on the produce is very important. Because nobody is producing just to produce, just to dump surplus. He is producing because he wants to monetize it. So therefore, we will have to adopt a robust system of post-production. And many a time, this robust post-production has been our biggest weakness everywhere. So these three variables, I would like to repeat, higher productivity at lower cost of production and optimal returns, price returns on the produce. These are the three basic things. And these three variables have to be controlled and do everything possible to improve the efficiency of these things so that the farmers get it. However, Please remember what I started with, that these have to be based on the principle of sustainability. Because we are not here to increase the welfare of the farmer or income of the farmer in one single year. The farmer has to get increasing incomes year after year. If that has to be done, sustainability is the answer. And there is one more element that you must remember. So the fourth variable is sustainability. And sustainable development goal talks about sustainability. It talks about climate change and coping mechanisms. The fifth most important thing for anybody who wanted to do good agriculture or evolve good policy is what is called risk management. Agriculture, as you know, is the riskiest of profession anywhere on this earth. All other things, the service sector or manufacturing sector, they are mechanical processes where the supply can be controlled. I'm a manufacturer of car, I can estimate the demand for 1,000 cars, I manufacture 1,000 cars. If the demand goes up to 1,200, everything is there, I get extra labor and produce 200 extra cars by working 24 hours. Because time and season have no reference to production of cars. It's a mechanical process. But what about agriculture? Agriculture is a biological process. Whether it's crops, whether it is livestock, dairy, fishery, any aspect of agriculture is a biological process. If it is a biological process, it is bound by seasons. It is bound by climatic parameters. Which only means that even though there is a lot of demand for mango, I am not able to produce mangoes to meet the demand. Or there is no mango demand this season, I am not able to tell my tree, please produce less. The tree says, no, not me now, you planted me, I am going to use so many mangoes. So supply is not in our hand. If supply is not in our hand, we cannot tweak the demand. So therefore, agriculture is extremely risky. And it is vulnerable to monsoons, vulnerable to pests, it is vulnerable to diseases, it is vulnerable to certain factors. And it is also vulnerable to market demand. So therefore, what is commonly called, it is influenced or a function of two M's, monsoons and markets. Both are not in our control. So how do we bring in systems for risk management such that the farmers do not suffer violently from the deviations in both monsoons and markets that are natural? So these are the five elements the entire strategy has to be built around. You get me? Would you like to ask any questions? These are the five variables. Any strategy has to be built on these five pillars. There are many other simple ones, but these are the five broad principles. Are you all with one with me till now? These young boys and girls? You understood? What about you, friends? Thank you. Yeah. So our strategy has to be to actually protect the farmer from these things. Now let's come back to the surplus factor. I told you that can we have a demand and price forecasting system, because if we are going to have a demand-led system, that means we are now going to say that I am going to produce. I told you that we cannot control the production, but still we can bring in some elements of control on the production. How is that? So if we are able to have a price and demand forecasting mechanism for the country and for the globe, to that extent, I can take a more informed production decision at the macro level. Today, what is happening? There is what is called as a lag period. Right? You see that the prices have gone up this year, then most farmers tend to shift to that particular crop in the ensuing, in the subsequent season. They all think they are going to get good prices. And then we see the production surpluses, too much of arrival in the market, it's a glut situation, prices fall. And that is called as a popwell model. And that year, since the prices have fallen, the next season all the farmers withdraw from the crop, there is a shortage of supply, prices have gone up. So you will see this kind of peaks and troughs, and that popwell model is so common to agriculture. So can we now help the farmers to evade this popwell theory by only having a price and demand forecast? Just come to think of it, you know, all of us are in the same boat. United States Department of Agriculture, USDA, they have a very strong mechanism of price and demand forecasting. They are studying the price and demand forecast the world over and advising their farmers. And we don't have that. And it's not so difficult. It is very simple. There are statistical tools, and we have ourselves put in our own country that it is possible for us to predict prices as accurately as 97%. Karnataka has shown the way. Tamil Nadu Agricultural University has shown the way. There is a simple NIAM model. But then we have not been able to deploy that properly. So we need to now bring in that in all our countries and say, let's try and assess what is the likelihood of a demand for a particular commodity in the next season, next year or 2 years hence, because that will call for studying the tastes and preferences and other kinds of demand, the production in different countries, etc. So if we are able to have a robust price and demand forecasting system, and then in real time we are able to transfer that information to the farmers, then possibly the farmers, before the production season begins, will decide on how much to grow. The state governments will design their policies accordingly. Or the government of India will design its policy accordingly. The state government will say, alright, I am not going to give too many seeds for jawar. I want to give too many seeds for ragi. I am going to give something else. That is what the price and demand forecast says. So it is very important that all of us have the proper price and demand forecast, and that is one way of de-risking the market mechanism. The second way of de-risking market mechanism is to have very strong storage and transport system. I will give you the example of tomato. That why Kolar farmers are not getting good prices, while the tomato is costing so much in Delhi or in, you know, in Ludhiana, for example. It only means that the production center of Kolar in Karnataka is not being connected with the consumption center in Punjab or Delhi. A simple example, quinoa, for example, is grown in Punjab. It was being produced there, not many people were eating in Punjab. But once they were able to establish a good agri-logistics, that means a transportation system connecting mobilization of quinoa in Punjab, transporting them through a proper reefer van to Bangalore market, the prices went up for the farmers in Punjab. And the number of reefer vans in Punjab have increased to 1200, as against only 10 a few years back. It only shows that if we are able to connect properly a production center and a consumption center, we will be able to increase the prices for the farmers and benefit the farmers. So we need a very good agri-logistics system. Agri-logistics means transportation and storage. Storage means according to commodity specificity. A potato requires a particular kind of import storage. Tomato requires something else. Onion requires something else. Unfortunately, many a time we do not do this analysis. What have we done, let's say in India? We say we've got a lot of cold storages. But 75% of our cold stores are all meant only for potato. Whereas we require more of cold stores for other commodities. Or, a cold store alone is not enough. You know, it is like saying that I built a very beautiful campus here, but there is no road connecting from city center of Jaipur to this place. What is the point of having this? How are the people going to travel here? So common sense says you also have a connectivity. So when you talk about cold stores, it has to be an integrated cold store. Many a time in India we thought cold store means cold system means cold store. Yes, we have cold storages. But how to connect them? So So an integrated cold chain, it means we need packing houses, we need staging houses, we need reefer vans which can carry them, we need storages. That is called integrated cold chain. You just can't have one component and leave out the other. So whenever you make any analysis or any requirement, please see from end to end. Otherwise, we'll be making a barren investment. It produces no result. And it would produce no result at all. So integrated cold chain is what is required. So in India, for example, today, we have so much of cold store facilities, but disproportionate number of transport systems. So we need to think through every time. So an agri logistic therefore requires good dry storage, good cold storage. Onions require a particular kind of storage. The ventilated cold put-outs are required. So we need to have commodity-specific agri logistics. So when you have a good agri logistics, we are able to connect the production and the consumption zones. So there is one way of de-risking agriculture, right? And that is an integral part rather than prerequisite to marketing. So you must remember that I must take all steps to de-risk. Now let's come to marketing per se. I would like you to understand there are two terms. One is marketing, one is monetization. Normally we always talk about marketing. We think that okay, I produce, I sell. But I told you that yes, we have a good market, let's call it an efficient market. But are efficient markets enough for the farmers to realize good price? That's a question you should ask and answer. We may have a very efficient market in the country. But then, as they say in economics once again, a good market is a necessary condition, but it is not a sufficient condition. Right? For anything to fulfill, we must fulfill both necessary condition and the sufficiency condition. If I want to discover good prices, I need good markets. But I need to reach that market first. So if I need to reach out, I need to have good agri logistics. And if I want to reach out after 1 year, I need good storage facility. And everything cannot be stored because agriculture produces is biological product. It is a living organism. As long as it is a living organism, it is bound to get vulnerable. It is bound to die. And that's how milk dies, fruit dies, even jawar dies, pulses die, oilseeds die after that. Only that the length of death is different. You may be able to store something for 1 year, something for 2 years, but something not more than 4 hours. Milk cannot be stored beyond 4 hours, for example. It's a living organism. So we need to have a system of quick value addition. So in marketing is called as time integration and space integration. If I produce this season in October, I should be able to keep it in a form so that I can sell it next October. Because if I take all my produce, let's say India takes all its produce to the market today, the demand is bound to be less because there's so much surplus, prices are bound to fall. Whereas we should, if you want to control supply, I told you we need to control supply the way the mechanical processes do, like car manufacturer does. If I want to control my supply, I need to store it, transform that into another form. Let's say tomato, I convert it to tomato puree. So that it goes into formation of the kitchen. I convert fruits into fruit juice so that it can be stored and sold next season. So we need to integrate a production over space and time. Then we'll be able to transfer good prices to the farmer. Are you getting me there? Or time means I produce today, I sell next year. Or space means I produce in Jaipur but sell it in, let us say, Johannesburg. Right? So that is how we'll be able to transfer good prices to the farmer and thereby we're de-risking. If we have several methods of de-risking farmers on the post-production stage, we should also bring in de-risking mechanism at the production stage. How do we do that? Modern technologies are available. Today, let's say, for example, just like price forecasting, we can have a weather forecasting. A good weather forecasting mechanism. And real-time transfer of the data to the farmer will help the farmer to take advanced action and protect himself against the probability of a danger. We had, in our country, for example, Karnataka has got the best infrastructure for weather forecasting. The weather forecasting center set up in Bangalore, at every single decentralized OP level, have got automatic rain gauge station, weather gauge station, telemetry stations, where the data is continuously fed to the centralized store, data store. That data is continuously interpreted, analyzed, interpreted, and then based on that, they are able to inform the farmers what is the likelihood of the rainfall, temperature, climate, etc. And an experiment showed that the group of farmers who benefited from this particular data were able to take advanced action and reduce their losses and gain in productivity as well as in profits. And that group of farmers which did not use this advanced information actually suffered more of losses. So today, the world over, we have the advantage of ICT, information communication technology. But most of us have not been able to centralize that data because we are not collecting it in a standardized format. Let's say Rajasthan collects in one format, Punjab collects in another format, Odisha collects in a third format. These data cannot speak to one another. So we need standardized data collection, data structure first. Second, we need standardized applications. The applications developed by different countries and within the country by different prefects, different states are so violent that the databases have become, you know, databases by themselves. They don't talk to one another. So we need an open data policy so that the architecture that is adopted for development of applications and centralized data store such that interoperability is possible is what is going to help the farmers to be informed in advance of likely impact of weather changes, of what is the likelihood of pest, for example, disease, for example. So the farmer takes advanced action. Only because farmers are not being informed in advance, they are not able to take any decision and they suddenly become victim of an unforeseen situation. So that risk management is very important. So likewise, you do all these kind of things and still, yes, agriculture continues to be risky. So therefore, government's policies are required to protect the farmers. Let's say crop insurance scheme is one way of de-risking. We have got life insurance, health insurance, car insurance, all kinds of insurance are there. But agriculture insurance is very difficult because agriculture, as I told you, is extremely vulnerable. So therefore, for any government to pay the premium, it is very difficult. If you have a market-centric insurance policy, it becomes costly. So how do we balance the market prices with the government's ability to pay the premium? So we need to structure our insurance policy in such a manner that the farmers are able to buy those policies and protect themselves against the likely risk that emerges in agriculture. And once again, we need to use technology. If we have proper technology, then the insurance agencies also will gain greater credibility in the data that is generated. So today, the short point is that technology and good professional management practices can help in de-risking agriculture at both production stage and at the post-production stage. And to an extent, we can bring the machine-like characters into agriculture today, because today we have got protected cultivation systems, polyhouses, greenhouses, aeroponics, hydroponics. There are so many new technologies that are emerging that if we can start cultivating as much as possible under these conditions, then we'll be able to control the supply. Let us say today water management, because water is one of the biggest critical factors everywhere, right? Agriculture world over, particularly in the developing countries, has been using nearly 80% of the water available in the country. Because industry had not grown, service sector had not grown, urban centers had not grown. But today, the urban centers are growing, they are asking for more water. Industry is growing, they are asking for more water. Service sector is growing, they are asking for more water. Agriculture has to start sacrificing the quantity of what it is utilizing. In India, for example, 86% of the total water available, utilizable water available, is used by agriculture sector. Now, can we continue with this? You can't. So, agriculture has to release some water from other sectors. Which means that agriculture has to start using water more efficient. Now, if you use a micro irrigation system, like a sprinkler system or a drip irrigation system, the water use efficiency increases. But generally, the farmers are used to a flooding system. Right? You release the water into the canal and then go home. Now, your field is flooded, using more than required water, and the tail end farmer is not getting the water. So we need to start using water more efficient. And micro irrigation, for example, is one technology. Today all of you have heard of the term precision agriculture. What does it mean? That means I be so precise in use of my inputs, whether it's water, pesticides, fertilizer, nutrient management, come what may. I be so precise that I only give as much as is required. Let us say water. The entire crop requires water only at the root zone. It doesn't require water everywhere. But we have been flooding our fields. So we can bring in micro irrigation system such that water is actually penetrating only at the specific root zone. And every crop has got a root zone. Some are more deeper in root, some are only on the surface. So based on the characteristic of the crop, you can actually say I will give only that much of water. More importantly today, we have got new technologies which will actually measure whether the plant requires a water or not, because a crop is a physiological system. So crop will, by measuring, it now possible for us to measure when does the water crop actually require water. So using that kind of new technology connected to the website, the executive engineer or engineer in charge of water management can release the water only when the crop is required, and not keep releasing it traditionally, conventionally. So it is possible for us to deploy new technologies and start managing our inputs. I would like to share with you people here, one of the new systems that India has brought is called soil health management. It is becoming an example to the world. Soil health management means collecting the samples of soil from every farm, analyzing it for various nutrient parameters, and recommending to the farmer that this is the status of your farm. Just like we test our blood, doctor at the pathology lab, it tests our blood and tells this is what is wrong with your blood, and then the doctor will prescribe what to do. Likewise, today, India in the last 3 years has adopted what is called universal soil health management, where we collect the sample, soil samples from every farm. It is tested for 12 parameters, major nutrients, secondary nutrients, minor macronutrients, and also physico-chemical properties. And then the farmer is told that yes, you need to add nitrogen but not phosphate, for example. Or if your soil is deficient in potassium, or it is deficient in micronutrients. Unfortunately, we have been blindly adding fertilizers. Whereas a crop, for example, requires nitrogen, requires phosphate, requires potassium. The crop may grow very beautifully. But to become a fruit, to become a grain, it requires phosphate. It is not there. It requires potassium. It is not there. So this soil health management, for example, now which has been adopted universally, imagine 12 crore farmers in India. There are 120 million farmers in India. All the 120 million farmers get a soil health card once in 2 years. So it is a very big exercise. So that kind of infrastructure has been built up. The kind of labs where you can test for these parameters. And we are now thinking what new technology can be adopted. So that is a precision agriculture. So we need to bring in new systems where we start looking at crops or animals, etc., in a way that they become efficient producers and not blind producers. So it is possible, therefore, that by doing this, you are decreasing the cost of production for the farmers. So the farmer needs to produce more at less cost. So I think I have now generally told you how to improve the productivity. The example of soil health management. We had a case study wherever the farmers used the data advice of the soil health management. Their yields increased by 10%. Their cost of cultivation decreased by 8%. Then imagine, just by efficient use of nutrients, they are able to produce more and at less cost. So we now need to bring in that kind of a precision farming into our agriculture where we are able to produce more. So I think this is what is really required, that today we need to shift from production to post-production system, have strong price and demand forecasting mechanism, and focus on monetization and not only on marketing. In the monetization, marketing is only one of the components. As soon as the grain or the fruit is harvested on the farm, at the farm gate, it requires a good harvesting practice. It requires a good processing facility, primary processing. It requires good storage, good transportation to reach out to the market, and then an efficient marketing system. And markets have to be not only efficient, but they must be effective. There's a little difference between efficiency and effectiveness. Efficiency means we are able to discover good prices. But effectiveness means whether the farmer is able to capture that value. In simple terms, all of you have heard what is called, what is the share of the producer in the consumer's rupee? If the consumer pays 1 rupee for any particular commodity, what part of that is going to the farm? We find that in case of cereals, for example, it generally 70 paise, that means 70% is actually going to the farm. But in case of fruits, it comes down to 50%. In case of milk, it comes down to 40%. In case of more perishable commodities, it will still come down to 30%. Now, is it possible for us to put in a system where 1 rupee becomes 2 rupees? That is efficiency. Now, 1 rupee is not enough. 1 rupee has become 2 rupees. We need competitive markets. We need to break monopolies. Today, APMCs, for example, in India become monopolies. We need to have alternate marketing channels. So the farmer goes to that market where he gets the best price. That is efficiency. Second one is effectiveness. That means if the price has risen from 1 rupee to 2 rupees, the farmer's share to 70 paise or 70% must go to minimum 80%. How do we make that effective? And that is, I think, the topic that you all want to discuss, agriculture value system. What you are calling value chain is actually an agri value system. That's the last part I want to talk to you about. A value system should be rather talk about agri value system. An agri value system comprises of value chain and supply chain. There are two components. So how do we build two robust systems, a value chain and supply chain, such that we are able to transfer maximum value to the farmer? And the value chain is not starting with the farm gate. It always starts right from the pre production. Unless we take care to make our system efficient right from pre-production to post-production, we will not be maximizing the share of the farmer in the final consumer's rupee. So an agriculture value system, which is based on a value chain and a value system, a supply chain, must be such that the farmer share in the value of that particular commodity is maximized. And that is what should be our final aim in life as far as agriculture is concerned. That he is producing, so he gets maximum. That is possible provided intermediaries are removed. Intermediaries, yes. Intermediaries also serve a purpose. Somebody, for example, who processes is serving a purpose. Somebody who transports is serving a purpose. Somebody who is storing is serving a purpose. But somebody who does not add any value and is simply taking advantage of the gullibility of the farmer or taking advantage of certain inefficiencies in the system, he is not an intermediary. He is actually a parasite of the system. So we need to have only those people who are actual service providers. to the extent you can have direct sale. Today, online trade is possible. We've got good online platforms like Amazon, for example. We also need to build those systems for agriculture where direct sale happens across the globe between the producer and the consumer. That can only happen provided we make our farmers literate, computer literate. We bring information to their doorstep. And more importantly, we develop common standards. Otherwise, what is called a mango in Bangalore may not mean same mango to somebody in Europe, right? Like Karnataka, Uttar Pradesh, Telangana, very popular for mango production. But then, the demand for a mango in Myanmar, is so different from what it is in Europe. A European loves a raw mango, whereas we in Asia want a yellow-colored, beautiful, you know, sweet mango. So I send my mango, Zutapuri, to Europe, nobody buys it. He wants a raw mango. I produce rice in Punjab, I send it to Thailand, for example, or Indonesia. They want a sticky rice. Whereas we want non-sticky rice in India, right? So we need to develop standards. That means I understand what is the taste and preference of people. When I say rice, sticky rice, it should have a common standard. If I say raw mango, this is the standard. So we need to have uniform standards across the country and the world ultimately. There are now standards which are developing. So that we are able to actually do virtual trading. Because when you say online trade is virtual trading. In a physical auction, I see and then buy. I know what I'm buying. But in a virtual trade, I'm not seeing. I can only see a picture. I only see the values. What is size, what is shape, what is color, whether it's pest free, disease free, residue, pesticide residue free, based on lab analysis. So if we want to have that kind of a virtual trade, then we need to have standards. We need to adhere to quality parameters. So I think all these things are still not respected in most of our countries. So if we really want to increase the income of the farmers, we now need to ultimately adopt what is called knowledge intensive agriculture. Not just information. There has to be information, there has to be knowledge, there has to be skill. So all these three, this is what Dr. Chandrasekhar and others have written in the next lecture. That we need information, we need knowledge, we need skill. Only when we can ensure these three things, then agriculture becomes not what it is perceived to be, an uneducated, non-school going boys profession. No. It becomes an educated youth's agri profession, which becomes an enterprise. It is not a subsistence profession. It is not an inevitable profession. It is a profession by choice. It is a profession based on knowledge. It is a profession based on enterprise. Only when we convert our agriculturists into entrepreneurs and build agriculture as an enterprise, only then can we make it net positive yielding profession. And our aim therefore is to convert this entire value chain into a net positive return yielding profession. This is what I had to say. As I told you, it's extremely expansive. You can speak for days without end, or you can speak within just an hour. So I think I'll stop here so that we can have more of interaction. You know, you may like to add by way of observations, comments, questions, criticism. You'll be welcome. Thank you.
Offered by you in the business world, where you talk about the need need for metamorphosis in the economic measure of sustainability from yield to total output. And I feel that this concept kind of echoes all the things that you've talked today and all the points that you've highlighted. And I just wanted to ask whether you were hinting towards more product diversification, risk management, and more market-oriented production. And if you could kindly elaborate a little bit more about the concept that you propose, and also in your opinion, what can be an effective strategy to sensitize smallholder farmers about this concept, given the constraints in countries such as Africa and South Asia?
I Thank you for your kind words. Yeah, I want to know the really meaning is that the way the yields are measured many a time, and we put ourselves against the Western world and then say that, you know, our yields are so low compared to theirs. And we are very good at self-deprecation. There are two ways of measuring the yields. One is yield per unit. Let's say, for example, crop. Yield per hectare of land in a year. Other one is to measure yield in terms of yield per year. Now, in most of our countries, we try to increase the cropping intensity. By growing short duration crops, we try to increase the cropping intensity beyond 100%. That means grow two crops in a year on the same piece of land, or three crops in a year on the same piece of land. When you shorten the duration of a crop, what happens is yields reduce, the potential yield reduces. But you get a time and land space to grow another crop on the same piece of land. Let us take a specific example. Punjab in India, rice and wheat are the cropping system. On an average, a Punjab farmer raises 5.5 tons of rice and he raises 5.5 tons of wheat. Both these crops are taken in the same year on the same land. So he is growing 11 tons per hectare in 1 year. Whereas a farmer, let's say corn farmer in America, he just grows one crop, because long duration crop of corn or maize he grows, and he raises around 11 to 12 tons per hectare. Right? Now you can say that, oh my god, the Punjab farmer is growing only 5.5 tons of rice in one per hectare, and then say that he's so low compared to somebody else. But on a yearly basis, the Punjab farmer is actually more or less equivalent to the American farmer. So that is one way of measuring. The second one, which is more important, which I talked about in that article, was in terms of income. Right? What does it mean? That now we saw the playthrough with the farmer producers organization of Mr. Shantumar. They are growing that chia. Okay? Now that chia cereal, millet for example, it can be sold at some, you get a net return of rupees 70,000 per acre. That per hectare, you get nearly 1.75 lakh of rupees, Indian rupees, right? If you grow paddy, you will get 35,000 rupees. But the yield of paddy is more than of chia seeds. But chia being a premium crop, will fetch you better market rates. So therefore, the farmer may prefer, from the income perspective, to grow chia instead of paddy. That's what I mean. So therefore, we need to diversify and grow something which will fetch me better market prices. If we are in a subsistence economy, I'm only trying to produce what I need from my family. But in a commercial economy, I know that I can buy things in the market. Today, let us say people are becoming health conscious. They want produce grown under what is called good agriculture practice, GAP practices. Or what is called organically cultivated produce. So organic produce, the yields reduce compared to an agrochemical based agriculture. However, the rates that fetch, the premium rates that organic produce fetches in the market will more than compensate for the yield loss vis-a-vis the agrochemical based agriculture. So then the farmer has to decide what is going to fetch a better rate in the market. Right? So that's what I was trying to say, that we need to make our farmers now conscious that you please shift from subsistence economy to commercial economy and start deciding on what you want to grow, how you want to grow based on the market situations. That's what I mean. Is it clear? Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I just have a single comment as well as a question. You've talked of policy, the policies that are supposed to be very conducive even to the farmers. You know, it's been one of the challenges in African countries whereby policy development and implementation hasn't been reached to the farmers. I just wanted to know the husband can also advise on how best or the best approaches that these nations can use to make sure that the farmers are involved at both levels, i.e. at development as well as implementation, to make sure that they are being proved from the country.
Yeah, I think, see, the question that you have raised or observation you have made is very relevant for all of us. Normally, there is a lot of gap between the policy and the implementation. Many times it is because the people concerned are not involved in the policy making. So maybe we are copying policy framework from other continents, other countries, or more from textbooks rather than based on practical experiences. It would always be good to have what is called a bottom-up approach to policy formulation. If we are able to involve the communities, then we will be able to formulate good policy. And yes, a policy is necessary to take one step forward. That means we want to bring about a transformation in the current practices so that we are able to achieve higher yields, for example. But I think it is important to estimate what is the capacity of absorption of the system. Unless we study the capacity of absorption of the people in terms of their knowledge, in terms of their ability to take up new skills, and assess what is the situation of infrastructure, the market for example, then the policy may be totally disengaged from what is possible. So I would say a policy should only take as much step forward as it is able to transfer to the people. Or in common English, only bite as much as you can chew. Many a time I think we become so ambitious in trying to do the best that we forget that our people are still not capable of absorbing those things. Particularly the advisors who come from other countries who don't understand the local culture, local capacities, they are advising something which is external to the entire culture, the civilization. Many a time they fail. So I would say that till such time as we achieve a particular critical level, we should be actually evolving slowly and steadily. It may be a little painful, but it's better to take that time and then reach that particular critical stage where people are now ready for leap forward. Right? And then maybe we can have more ambitions. And that is important. I hope I make some sense. Yes.
Well, thank you, Doc, for your presentation. So I come from Kenya. And in Kenya, the average age of a farmer is about 60, 70 years. So the focus currently is to get the young people, the youth, on board. And you know the expectation of the young people is quite high, and the average income from farming is slightly moderate. So maybe what thoughts can you give them to how we can bring in the young people to getting engaged in farming? Is it at the pre, at the production or at the post-production? Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I think that is one challenge everywhere now. Many youth, most of the countries don't want to stay in agriculture because they find that standard of living in rural areas is not comfortable. They don't have good access to education or health or what are called modern ways of living. So they all want to shift out of agriculture. But we need, I think, youth, particularly where the population in agriculture is still required. Today's youth get attracted to technology. They get attracted to good management practice. And agriculture actually requires today technology and management practice. So if we are able to introduce more of technology, more of management practices, I think the youth also will come. The youth, particularly educated in technology background, they, I think, are most apt for post-production, marketing, for example, or value addition, processing. That's where we need them. And it is not impossible to do that. We are already seeing in India, for example, many of the engineering graduates, particularly those who have worked more high quality in IITs, you know, Indian Institute of Technology, India is supposed to be the highest standard technology institute. Many of the youngsters who are studying in these kind of IITs or Indian Institute of Management, they are somehow coming back into agriculture. They want their plan to buy land, practice modern agriculture. Okay? So it is possible if we are able to sell and make agriculture a profit-oriented profession, which means that we need to have proper policies. So as long as we are able to adopt policies which will be conducive for generating profits, and then enable practice of technology, good management practices, I think the youth will come back to agriculture. Anything here?
Good afternoon, sir. I am Dipti Vasta, student of second year at CCS NIAM National Institute. My question is, what has been the impact of GST on agriculture, especially on doubling the farmer's income? What are your views? Has it been positive, negative, or
neutral? Yeah, see, this GST is still in the process of, you know, settling down. Okay. It's about a year plus now. So we have been constantly in touch with the Ministry of Finance, and they have responded. Wherever we found GST was having a negative impact, we have, you know, made our analysis, shared with them, and they have been very good. They have reduced the slab levels. For example, something was 28% has been brought down to 12%. Something was 12%, it has been brought to 5%, and sometimes even 0%. So there has been a lot of change. And I think what will happen is, as the response system improves and the volumes increase, government also is in a position to further reduce the slab levels. Today we have 4 slab levels, right? So I'm sure the good GST, as they say, is where we got minimal number of slabs. And most of the commodities come in the first slab, or at best the second slab. So agriculture has not been impacted negatively by GST. It will rather stand to benefit, because across the country you will have uniform rates. Like micro irrigation system, we had a concern because there are different rates for the pipeline, nozzle was something else. So it took some time for us to convince them that micro irrigation together, nozzles and pipeline, should be brought to the lower slab. So what was at 28 has now brought up to 12% slab. So there are changes, good things.
Sir, I would like to continue on this same question. As you said, the slab change for various products for agri. So for seeds, like, it has come under exemption. There is no GST for seeds that has been exempted. But for agri, fertilizers, it has been raised to 12%. So that is completely contradictory
to our doubling farmers'
income.
Because
we are trying to
giving
more mechanization in the field of agriculture. So why this contradiction?
No, you may have a point in that, but you know, they'll always look at the overall economy. Overall, you know, the tax receipts have to look at. But what our ministry is doing is, that see, tax alone is not a factor that influences the efficiency. Now, many a time, our farmers cannot afford a tractor, but still they purchase, right? So we would like to now promote what are called custom hiring centers or service centers. In a custom hiring center, every farmer need not buy his farm machinery. It is available for hiring. Right, at the district level, or at the block level, or at the village level. And the youngster like you can start a business where the farm machinery like Ola transport can be fired up. Right? And we also brought a new act called as Contract Farming and Services Act. Under this now, the companies can take a responsibility of input management. That means it's outsourced days, like you have outsourced here your canteen, for example. A group of farmers can get together and outsource various operations to this particular company. whether it is irrigation management, input pesticide management, fertilizer management, harvesting management. A group of farmers, farmer business organization, or larger number of farmers can get together, outsource the functions to a larger company. What happens? The scale of economy begins to operate there. Now, a drone comes, does the pesticide spray, for example. It's more cost efficient. And many a time, I spray pesticide at my farm, you do not spray, you are my neighbor. So all my pests go to your farm. Right? It doesn't bother whether it is my farm or your farm as long as it is able to forage. Whereas, if we have a common management system, all our farms get sprayed at the right time, at the same time. So both of us stand to benefit. So yes, taxation is one issue, but more important is the financial services. Like in Nepal I saw, the Prime Minister's, that particular scheme is there to promote farm machinery. It's called something as Nepal, they call it as some Pradhan Mantri, it's like our thing. They also have a scheme where they're promoting farm machinery through this system of custom management. But that way all countries are following different models. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah, we'll come there.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Rishikesh Pawar, student of CCS NIAM, PGDM ABM batch 1820. Sir, my question is regarding India's policy about MSP. So, recently we have seen that 14 crops have been given a 50% MSP hike, but the MSP which is given from government side is based on approach of A2 plus FM. Against the more recommended approach of C2. So, what difference do these two approaches exactly have on both parts, as government as a stakeholder and farmer as a stakeholder?
Yeah, it's a very big question and it takes very lot of time to explain to you. What we have given now, you know, A2 plus FL, right? What does it mean? A2 means, now we are talking about what is called a minimum support price. Okay, the government assures the farmer a particular support price. That means if they don't get the price in the market, government says I will come and buy. That's called MSP. The minimum support price is calculated based on data collection. First we do a field study. We calculate the average cost of production for different crops across the country. And that cost of production has got different components, right? One component is called A2. What is A2? All paid out costs by the farmer, whether it is cash or kind, right? For example, he engages labor for weeding purpose, alright? Or he has purchased some seeds, purchased some tractor, so many things, right? These are all A2 costs. He may have paid cash or kind. Family FL, A2 plus FL, FL is family labor. Because the entire family is engaged in agriculture. The question was, should we also impute some value to the family labor? Though they are working on their own farm, should we not impute some value to the family labor? So the market rate, that means there is an opportunity cost. If the farmer family had not worked on his own farm, may have gone and worked elsewhere. So that is called a market value. So a market value is imputed to the farmer family and that is also added to the cost of production. That is called A2 plus FL, right? Now what you are talking about is what is called a C2 cost, which farmers are arguing, like Shankumar. They are asking, give me C2 cost. What is C2? A2 plus FL. There are two more costs. And one that cost is called interest on the capital investment. That means I buy a capital irrigation system, I incur certain interest on that, they say you add that interest to that. And there's one more factor called opportunity cost, paid off cost. That means I am using my land for agriculture. If I had leased it out to somebody else, I would have got some rental on that. Government's argument is A2 plus FL is a rational cost. Because the other factor, where land is being used for yourself. If you are using for yourself, then you don't have a scope to rent it out to somebody else. You will rent it out to somebody else, you cease to be an agriculturist. So there is no rationality on that. Now, as regards the interest of the capital investments, there could be some rationality, but government always takes the overall view. Government is meant not only for farmers, government is meant for every citizen. Right? Now, let me talk of maybe the other hand. That if we pay too much to a farmer, for example, then it becomes that much costly for the consumer. The inflation will go up. So whenever pricing mechanism is adopted, when pricing is followed, we take into account not only the interest of the farmer, but what is its impact on the inflation? What is it going to mean in terms of intercontinental, inter-country comparisons? Because I told you, we cannot sell everything in our country. If I produce it at such a costly way, I cannot export. I need to be competitive, right? There are other countries competing with me for the same commodity. So take all these things into account. The government has taken a historic decision this time to say, I will take K2+L as a cost of production. Plus, for purpose of MSP, I will add a minimum of 50% of the cost of production as the margin of profit, right? Everything is done for profit, right? We talk about profit in the morning. So if cost of production is A2+L, we add 50% of that as the profit margin, and that becomes the minimum support price. So the historic decision taken by the government this year was, earlier the profit of margin, there was no threshold. It could be 20%, it could be 100%. But now government has said minimum 50%. It doesn't mean that is the maximum. Government also gives more than that. So on 14 crops that we saw today, the profit margin ranges from 50% to 96%. So crops like oil seeds, millets, pulses have all benefited much more than what wheat, much more than what paddy benefited or what other crop. But more important is that government also said, I will put in place a robust system of procurement. Otherwise, government was simply notifying the MSP. We were not procuring anything beyond paddy and wheat. We were procuring a bit of pulses, for example. But now government has come out with what is called PM Asha, right? Pradhan Mantri Annadata Aayal Samrakshan Yojana Abhiyan. That is farmers income security yojana. So government is today going to procure pulses, oil seeds, millets, paddy, cotton, jute, wheat, everything. For the first time, we are now going to have a robust system. So I think it's a good thing.
ಒಂದು ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ರೈತರಿಗೆ 7% ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಲ್ಲಿ ಕೊಡ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರ. ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಸಬ್ಸಿಡಿ ಕೂಡ 3% ಕೊಟ್ಟು 3%ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಪೇ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ರೈತರ ಉತ್ಪಾದಕ ಕಂಪನಿಗಳು ಗ್ರೂಪಲ್ಲಿ ವ್ಯವಸಾಯ ಮಾಡ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಆ ಗ್ರೂಪ್ ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ 12% ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟಲ್ಲಿ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನವರು ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಇದು ಯಾಕೆ ಈ ಥರ ಡಿಫರೆನ್ಸಿಯಲ್, ಅದನ್ನು ಯಾಕೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಕ್ರಮ ತಗೊಂಡಿಲ್ಲ? ಒಂದು ಎರಡನೇದಾಗಿ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸ್ ಕೊಡಿದೆ. ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಬೆಲೆ ಕುಸಿತ ಆದಾಗ ಆ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಟಾಕ್ ಮಾಡಿಕೊಂಡ್ರೆ 80% ಸಾಲ ಕೊಡ್ತಿರೋ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ ಇದೆ. ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ ಇಂಪ್ಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಫ್ರೀಯಾಗಿ ಇಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಕಾಶ ಕೊಟ್ಟು ಲೋನ್ ಕೊಡುವಂಥ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ ಆಗಿದ್ರೆ ಶೋಷಣೆ ತಪ್ಪುತ್ತದೆ. ಎರಡು ಮೂರನೇದು MSP ಅಂತ ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ಸುಗರ್ ಕೇನ್ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲ್ ಆರ್ಡರ್ಲ್ಲಿ ಕಬ್ಗೆ FRP ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. FRPಗಿಂತ ಕಡಿಮೆ ದುಡ್ಡು ಕೊಟ್ಟರೆ ಸುಗರ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರಿ ಮೇಲೆ ಕ್ರಮ ತಗೋತದೆ ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಸರ್ಕಾರ. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಆಗಿ MSP ಯಾಕೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಅಳವಡಿಸಬಾರ್ದು ಅಂತಕ್ಕಂಥದ್ದು ಮೂರು ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಐಡಿಯಾಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರು.
ಓಕೆ, ಆ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಪೀಕ್ ಇನ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಮೊನ್ನೆ ಬಂದು ಕೊಂಚ ಸಿ. ಈಗ ಮೊದಲನೇದು ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಸಬ್ವೆನ್ಷನ್ ಸ್ಕೀಮ್ ಇದೆ. ಎಷ್ಟುವರೆಗೆ ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಏನು ಸೌಲಭ್ಯ ಇದೆ, ಪಾಪ್ ಅಪ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸರ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸ್ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಸಜೆಷನ್ ಇದೆ. ಎರಡನೇದೇನು, ಈ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಿಂಗ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಇದೆ, ನಾವು ಹೇಳೋದು ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಇದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಕಮಿಟಿ ಮಾಡಿ ಈ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಿಂಗ್ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿಫೈ ಹ್ಯಾಪ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ 165 billion ton ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಸ್ಟೋರೇಜ್ ಕನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಆದರೆ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಿಂಗ್ ಎಷ್ಟಿದೆ? ಕೇವಲ 39 billion ton. ಅಂದರೆ 165 39 ಯಾಕಾಗಿದೆ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ನಮ್ಮ ಗೋಡೌನ್ಗಳೇನಿವೆ ಈ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸ್ ಅಂತ ಡಿಕ್ಲೇರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಯಾವ್ಯಾವ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳು ಬೇಕು ಆ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳು ಇಲ್ಲ. ಎರಡನೇದು, ನಮ್ಮ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಿಂಗ್ ಕಾರ್ಪೊರೇಷನ್ ಅಥಾರಿಟಿ ಏನಿದೆ ಅವ್ರ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಇಷ್ಟು ಕಾಂಪ್ಲಿಕೇಟ್ ಆಗಿಬಿಟ್ಟಿದೆ, ಈ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟ್ರೇಷನ್ ಮಾಡೋದೇ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಷ್ಟ. ಈಗ ವೇರ್ ಹೌಸಿಂಗ್ ಅಥಾರಿಟಿ ಮತ್ತು ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡು ಫಸ್ಟ್ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟ್ರೇಷನ್ ಆಗಿ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿಫೈ ಆಗಬೇಕು. ಎರಡನೇದು, ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿಫೈ ಆದ ನಂತರ ನಮ್ಮ ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನವ್ರು ಏನಂದ್ರೆ ಅವರು ಕೂಡ ಲೋನ್ ಕೊಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಬರಬೇಕು. ಇವತ್ತು ಬ್ಯಾಂಕ್ನವರು ಕೂಡ ಈ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ. ಇನ್ನೂ ಒಂದು ದೊಡ್ಡ ಕಷ್ಟ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಏನು, ನಾವು ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಕೊಡ್ತೀವಿ, ಈ ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಕೊಟ್ಟಾಗ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ರಿಪೇಮೆಂಟ್ಗೆ 3% ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ರಾ ಇಂಟ್ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಸಬ್ವೆನ್ಷನ್ ಇದೆ. ಆದ್ರೆ ಒಂದ್ ವರ್ಷ ಆಗಿದೆ, ಈ ನಾವು ಜೂನ್ ದಲ್ಲಿ ಲೋನ್ ಕೊಟ್ವಿ, ಈ ಪೋಸ್ಟ್ ಹಾರ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಲೋನ್ ಅಕ್ಟೋಬರ್ ದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೊಡಬೇಕು. ಇದು ಕೊಟ್ಟ ತಕ್ಷಣ ಅವ್ರು ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ನೋನೆ ಆಗ್ಬಿಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಬೈಫರ್ಕೇಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕಾಗಿದೆ. ಈಗ ಈ ಲೋನ್ ತಗೊಂಡ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅವಾಗ ಕ್ರಾಪ್ ರಿಪೇಮೆಂಟ್ ಮೇಲೆ ಯಾವುದೇ ಬಾಧ್ಯತೆ ಬರಬಾರದು. ಅವಾಗ ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ, ರೈತರು ಮುಂದೆ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತು ರೈತರು ಮುಂದೆ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಬ್ಯಾಂಕರ್ಸ್ ಮುಂದೆ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ, ಬೇರೆ ಅವಸ್ಥೆ ಫೆಸಿಲಿಟೀಸ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ. ಸೊ ಅದು ಡೆಫಿನೆಟ್ ನಾವು ಹೇಳೋದು ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್ ಇದೆ. ನಾವು ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ನೀನು ಕಾಯ್ಕೊಂಡು ಮಾರಾಟ ಮಾಡಪ್ಪ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ, ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಫೈನಾನ್ಷಿಯಲಿ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಂತ್ ಮಾಡ. ಇದ ಮೂರನೇದು ಏನು ತಾವ್ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರಿ, ಇದು MSP ಮೇಲೆ ಖರೀದಿ ಆಗ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಯಾಕೆ ನಾವು ಇದ್ದರಬಾರ್ದು ಅಂತ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಏನಾಗುತ್ತೆ ಅವಾಗ, ಇಲ್ಲ ಶುಗರ್ ಗನ್ ಆಗಿದೆ ಯಾಕಂದ್ರೆ ಕೆಲವೊಂದು ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್ರೀಸ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಬಟ್ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಟ್ರೇಡರ್ಸ್ ಪರ್ಚೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ನಲ್ಲಿ ಸಪೋಸ್ ನಾವು ಆ ರೀತಿಯ ಪ್ರೆಷರ್ ಹಾಕ್ಬಿಟ್ಟಿವಿ, ಅವ್ರು ಪರ್ಚೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ತಿಳಿಸ್ಬಿಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಈ ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ ಹೋದ ವರ್ಷ ಮಹಾರಾಷ್ಟ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ರೀತಿ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು, MSP ನೀವು ಪರ್ಚೇಸ್ ಮಾಡಲಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಕ್ರಿಮಿನಲ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಹಾಕ್ತೀವಿ ಅಂತ. ಅವಾಗ ಎಲ್ಲ ಟ್ರೇಡರ್ಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೈಕ್ ಹೋಗ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಇದು ಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿ ಸರಿಯಾಗಿಲ್ಲ, FAQ ಇಲ್ಲ, ನೂರು ಕತೆ ಹೇಳ್ಬಿಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಸೊ ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಎಲ್ಲಿವರೆಗೆ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಗೆ ಪರ್ಚೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಇರುವುದಿಲ್ವೋ ಅಲ್ಲಿವರೆಗೆ ನಾವು ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಡಿಪೆಂಡ್ ಆಗಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಪರ್ಚೇಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂತಕೊಂಡು ಅದೊಂದು ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಬರುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಈ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರೊಕ್ಯೂರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಎರಡು ಬ್ಯಾಲೆನ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಈಗ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಉದ್ದೇಶ ಏನು, ರಿಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ಸ್, ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಅನ್ನ ಇನ್ನು ಸುಧಾರಣೆ ಮಾಡೋದು, ರೈತರಿಗೆ ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಬೆಲೆ ಸಿಗ್ತಿ, ಯಾವಾಗ ಸಿಗುದಿಲ್ವೋ ಅವಾಗ ಪ್ರೊಕ್ಯೂರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಈ ರೀತಿ 60% ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಬೆಲೆ ಸಿಗ್ಬೇಕು, ಇನ್ 40% ಪ್ರೊಕ್ಯೂರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಈ ರೀತಿ ಒಂದು ಬ್ಯಾಲೆನ್ಸ್ ತರಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ. So therefore, governments will have to intervene once a while to come to the aid of the farmer to procure at the minimum support price and ensure that he gets some kind of remunerative price, right? However, no government can afford to purchase all that is produced, and therefore we need to have a good market system. That's what I think. And you had something to say. Yeah, last question.
Maybe last question.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for a very wonderful presentation. It seems to me that you have a very careful approach and a very clear way of moving to increase farmers' income. Back home in Uganda, I think there are efforts to do that also, although I think in a different way. We have a group of scientists who seems to think that going GMO would be one of the ways. And question kindly, what could be your view and your feeling about the GMO? Recently, we had almost a fight in our parliament about the same. There are those who are pro and the majority don't want it. Thank
you. Yeah, yes, I think this, subject of GMO, genetically modified organism, is a very sensitive subject. There always people take pro or anti stand. You know? Now what, at the first level, what does the GMO do? It only helps in increasing the productivity. We have improved seeds, we have got higher tea varieties, we got hybrids, we got genetically modified seeds, right? Each of this is actually nothing but hybridization. We are, these are conventional hybridization, where a genetically modified crop is a not a conventional, unconventional way of changing the DNA structure, right? But what does it do? Just like hybridization, improves the yield, for example. It's good for the system. Likewise, if GMO is increasing the yield, good for the system. It is bringing in resistance against pests, good for the system. Bringing in resistance against the disease, good for the system. It is bringing in efficiency of resources, good for the system. But the issue why it, you know, generates so much of heat and sensitivity is that in the genetically modified organism, we are crossing the DNA of two different species. In hybridization, within the same species, like wheat, we take one variety, another variety, one land race, another land race, but the DNA structure is same. But in a GM crop or a GM organism, we are taking, changing the DNA structure. So the people who are anti-GM, they feel that we don't know what are its consequences for a period of time and whether we can have control over an organism for a period of time. So it is raising certain fears. And people who take from the perspective of ethics, there is an ethical side also to that. They feel that it cannot be ethical for a human being to interfere with the natural evolution, natural DNA structure. So there is ethical consequence. There is also a scientific consequence. We don't know what is going to happen. So as you know, every system, every country has got its own regulatory system. Like in our country, we also have genetic engineering appraisal system. Very rigorously, the new GM crop is tested for its toxicity, for its, you know, impact on the environment, etc. Yet, there is a lot of resistance even in India. So I would say, my personal opinion of course, not the government opinion, is that we have got food crop and non-food crop, right? I think in non-food crop, there may not be so much of a danger, right? Agriculture should also start going for industry, for example. It need not be only for, you know, feeding the human beings and the cattle. So for non-food sector, there may not be that much of an ethical aspect as in a food sector where toxicity is always involved. I think we can go to that extent. But more importantly, I would say, many of our countries have not yet exhausted the genetic diversity that is already available. That is in India, we have only exhausted only 1% of the genetic diversity that is available. So there is still scope for conventional hybridization, conventional hybrid varieties. When we have that thing, why do you have to try that? So we can wait for some more time till science is able to convince all of us that there is no danger. Or we are able to convince those people who are working, I mean, who are arguing from ethical perspective, wait for some time and adopt the conventional method of hybridization. That's what my personal opinion is. This Gyan Deep serial is a wonderful thing. You know, all your participants, students and staff will be exposed to people from outside. And outside this view, it will generate a lot of discussion and debate and benefit your organization. So I must congratulate you for the new initiatives that you have taken. I know he has taken many initiatives since he has joined here. And I would request all our staff, work as a team. He's only one among you, so you must all work together. If the institution grows, it's good for everybody. We'll have more people, more infrastructure, more facilities, there will be more of inspiration in the environment, and you get more opportunities and you can also make a name for yourself. So I think ultimately team is very important. The team spirit is extremely important. an organization can grow only when there is a team spirit. So I can see Dr. Chandrasekhar, the river success team. In fact, when we selected him, well, I have been seeing him for a long time. When we selected him only because we knew that he is capable of providing that kind of a leadership and working as a team member, right? And I am sure that we will all work together and make this organization a very good one. Then you see, named after Choudhury Charan Singh, is a great leader, let me tell you. He's a farmer's leader. One institution named after a farmer's leader, you must make it a good institution. Farmer's leader, our resident institute is there. So please work to make that name a formidable name. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Ashok Dalwai, he covered the vast canvas of doubling farmers' income. As sir has rightly pointed out, to get the whole essence of DFI, you have to go through those 13 modules which are posted on the website. What he focused on that DFI as a strategy has been very participatory. It fulfills the SDG goals, and India's strategy towards DFI is as to how to link the increased yield to the market by deploying ICT, by de-risking farmers, and how we have to go forward for a knowledge intensive agriculture, moving people from subsistence agriculture towards more commercialization. Whatever he said, each one of us have absorbed it very finely. The kind of interest it generated amongst the international delegates, be it from Kenya, Uganda, Malawi and Nepal, it was very, very interesting to have questions from the students and the delegates. I thank you, sir. We are indeed very grateful for having started our first lecture series well, and I am very sure first lecture goes well, the rest will follow same, sir. Thank you for your blessings and giving us your enlightened lecture to us.